Guru Kripa Kevalam. Namaste and welcome everyone to Satsang today. Sadhguru Shri Muji Baba Ki
Jai.
Often I speak of this 3D ego. Someone remembers? What are the 3Ds?
Duality.
Huh?
Duality.
Desire.
Intuition.
Duality means the sense that there are two, you see? Or the sense that it is not one. You see? Desire means I want something because I am not all there is. Then therefore I want something. And doership is what to do to achieve that, to get what I want. So the seeker is a very good example of this, the seeker identity. Is a very good example of this. One is the idea that I am seeking God itself is the idea of separation from God. So there is duality in that. You see? The desire is what? To find God, be one with God, to realize the self, God, whatever you call it. You see? And doership is, now what do I need to do? Which satsang to go to? Which practices to do? How much in silence to be, you know, these kind of prescriptions to try and achieve this desire, which is the desire for the self. So, but the funny thing about the spiritual seeker is that the concepts that it has is that God is one, there are no two, you see? So that basic premise of separation between self and me or God and me itself is contradicted by the concepts that the seeker seems to hold. You see? And that is why it can seem like it is such a confusing journey at times. Because how you are operating in a way is in contradiction to the concepts that you are holding. Which is unique in a way to the ego affliction. You see, at least if your ego affliction is for money, you see, or some material benefit, you see, then the concepts that you're holding are in alignment with that. My life will be better, I am this body mind, if I had this much money, then my life will be better. So at least that inherent contradiction of seeking something which is already called the self. Yourself, you are seeking yourself. You see, what can be actually funnier than that? It's just that it's not funny now, it's not a joke because there's so much suffering involved. You see, otherwise, what a joke it would be. You are seeking yourself. You see, I am seeking. What are you seeking? Myself. You see, no wonder people in the world think we are crazy. Because at least if you go to them and say, what are you seeking? I'm seeking a comfortable life. I'm seeking this goal for myself. You see, at least it seems to make sense. And they say, what are you seeking? I'm seeking myself. You see, isn't it ludicrous? You see? So in actuality it is, because you see, this inherently contains the notion of separation, that there is a self and there is a me, there is a God and there is a me. So, and then we do all kinds of silliness to try and get to ourselves. All kinds of silliness to get to myself. How will you ever get to yourself? You see? But before you can define that, you have to tell me what you already are. You see? So, look at the hold of concepts over us, that we are convinced that we are the separate individual wanting to find the self. You see? Then all these funny things happen. Because there is a sense of duality, we also make action, you see, out of just perception, or a sensation. We call that action. What is action? You see, nobody's ever met the actor, the agent, you see, the one that has this volition. Nobody's ever met this one, you see. So, what do we mean by doing or action?
Change, something has changed.
So, movement,
Yeah,
you
movement.
see. Movement is what? Let's call it perception. Is that okay? That's a perception, you see, because you can't say movement unless you're perceiving something, you see. So, this perception is happening, you see. How does that become a doing or an action?
And I thought claiming that actor.
Huh?
And I thought which claims
An I thought which claims if I am the actor, you see. But also the you thought which claims that you could be the actor, you see, whoever that you is, isn't it? So any idea of separation is inherent in this idea of action, you see. In a way, we are not saying that spiritually speaking, we say things like, oh, the ocean is moving the waves, the ocean is doing the movement of the waves, or something like that, you see. But really, we don't think that way. We see that the waves are just coming and going. It is just a perception. We are not ascribing, you see, doership to it, or blame to it, or credit to it. We're not saying the ocean is being very nice today, it is moving the wave, you see. So, these kind of motives are not ascribed. You see? So how is it that if this is happening, then we feel like I am doing it or you are doing it? Who is that one? Did we find any such thing? You see? So the end of the idea of doership, I'm enjoying this actually. The end of the idea of doership is not to figure out ultimately who is the doer, you see? Not to move that level of doership from individual to some idea of greater, you see? But to see that the notion itself is flawed, and the idea that there is doing itself has no basis. You see? Now again, our intellect is made up of these boxes, so don't try to fit it in like that. You see, what am I understanding? What is he saying there? Not like that. So let the words also flow through you, you see, into you. Let them do their work on their own. Because if you try to grasp at them, they will, you see, react in some way. So this is not understandable, because so much of our conditioning is based on these ideas of doership. You see, because we've been taught ever since we were little, don't do this, do that, this is good, this is bad, bad boy, good girl, you know, these kind of things. So it is so much inherent in the conditioning that don't try to make fresh conditioning out of this. Just see if you can, just for a moment, you see. So there is so-called activity and movement, which we can also explore later, but how does that become a doing?
This seems to be a will. I mean,
Yeah, so seems. So are we willing to rest on seems now, or is the will also apparent?
what do you mean, apparent?
In the sense that, are you meeting this will as well, or is it just a presumption?
Sorry. myself as as a separate.
No, don't think at all.
Okay.
So, this needs no thinking. You see, there is perception happening which is independent of thinking. Is there perception of will also?
No.
No. You see, so then you are thinking it or presuming it or inferring it. Isn't it? And nobody, although this exploration has happened for thousands of years, has been able to solve this debate of free will versus God's will. Because the notion of will itself is flawed. You can have inference on inference and figure out this way or that way. You can ascribe it here, you can ascribe it there. It doesn't really matter because this itself is just an inference. It is just a label. It is just a term. Is it? For a while, of course, it is a label which brings great relief. It is fine. Is it? In the sense, if we say God's will, is it? It's great relief. It's fine. Is it? But soon we have the ability also to make victimhood out of that. If all is God's will, why isn't he being nice to me? Is it? What did I ever do? Is it? Why do bad things happen to good people? Yeah, these kind of notions can also be built on a sort of greater placing of will. You see? But have you ever met this will? So all we have met, like he said, is movement or sensation or perception, whatever you call it. You see? And we've put so much burden on that. This is somebody's will. This is good, this is bad, this is what I should be doing, this is not what should be done. You see, all of this is based on the notion of doing, which we have never actually met, we have only inferred. The idea of doer, the idea of experiencer, you see, as an individual or a greater, either way, is just an inference.
So when there's no doership, there's no doer and no will?
When you see there is no doership, then what would doer be? Nothing. This is just like that, in the sense that the terms themselves lose their meaning. Not that there ever was one and that dissolves. You see? It's just that we've used these terms to convince ourselves, like if you were conditioned to believe since you were small that you are the one that is making this world go round, or something like this. You see? And if you were, really part of such a sect or religion or something like that, you see? Then you would end up believing that. You see? And you are, I'm keeping this up. You see? So if I stop beating my heart or something, then the world will stop. So I better keep doing it. You know, these kind of ideas. So, but these are just notions, just thoughts. Is it? What makes something a doing? And this is very good because most of our suffering is doing related. Guilt, pride, resentment, remorse, all of these things are about making doing or action out of just movement. Of course, movement is also just a term, but okay, we'll keep that for a minute. Have you met the one who's doing this? Is it?
Met it as an idea.
Only as an idea. That's what exactly what I mean. Have you met it? Is it? Not inferred it or thought of it.
Perception.
Yeah, but the one who is doing, is it?
That is also a mental perception, a thought.
Exactly. Just a thought.
So the ego is gone, there is no free will.
Huh?
If there is no ego and no I, then there is nothing as free will.
What we are actually investigating is that, okay, suppose there was free will. Okay? Now, whose would it be?
The individual. When we talk about free will, it's
exactly. So it is an individual, and what are we finding? There's no such thing as individual.
Yeah.
So the guy in the next room, you see, he has 11 toes. You see? Now, one of the toes is called free will. You see? Now, the thing is that there is no guy in the next room. So, what does he have? 9, 10 or 11 toes? You see? So, if it isn't there, how can it have or not have? So, the whole debate about free will versus God's will is actually another play of the intellect only. Because there is, you see, where is the entity to have that free will? Whose free will would it be if it was there? You see? I am saying, in fact, that there is no such thing as doing itself. So, who are we trying to pin the blame of doing on? You see?
The whole game, I mean, like the whole thing, actually just depends on whether you show us by looking that there isn't an individual, right?
Yeah.
So if there isn't an individual, then the whole thing collapses in a sense.
Yeah, but it doesn't collapse because I said this thing, no? Like if you move it to a higher power, then you see, and say, okay, there is no individual, but consciousness is doing it. You see. Because we are used to replacing notions with new notions. When I am saying, okay, there is no individual, then okay, there is no individual, therefore then it is God who is doing it. You see? Then what happens with that is, although a great sense of relief can come, there can also be the sense, oh, why is grace doing this to me? You see? Somebody said one time. Whatever that happens, you can always blame it on grace.
But if we see that there was no me or there is no me, like you said, the man has 100 tools or 1 or 0.
Exactly.
But if the man only isn't there, then for who is the God and who is the grace and who is the will and all the whole system
is gone.
Who wears the law, the justice, karma?
Gone.
Exactly. I mean.
Yeah. So. And that it is gone is also gone. You see, that is the game, that it is neither is nor is gone. You see, because both are for that one who doesn't exist. You see, or both in the way define that one who doesn't exist. You see.
So there's no God doing, there's just doing.
I'm saying that there is this. How does this become a doing?
There's no doing either. It's just breathing is happening. It's a happening? I don't know.
Yeah, if you want to say. That is the second level of exploration.
Perception.
You see, even this perception, we'll go get to that. Same idea?
This is something that's like just kind of crumbled in recent times. Like, for some time, like it's felt clear like I'm not the doer. And yet then, like with my partner, like he still falls into identification like very frequently and generates like a lot of negativity and suffers. And it used to still feel like...
Why is he doing that?
Yeah. And it was just kind of... And there was also some sense of like... Why would you go with the mind? Like, you have been given everything. Like, you know, having received such grace to, like, have found a master and everything. Like, how could you kind of still go with the lie when you've been shown what is true? Like, why do you not stand in the truth? Why are you not remaining in the place of the seeing? And, and so that still used to feel quite real. And then just more recently, it's like, oh, my God. Like, not only... Because there was still this like this misunderstanding of, like, I'm not the doer, but he's still the doer. And then just to see that, like, oh, wow, like, there's really no choice. But I wanted to ask you if you'd be able to elaborate on, you know how sometimes Guruji says, like, if we do have a sense of, like, primordial choice, it's in that moment that the mind is, like, offering suggestion, and there's a sense of choice to, like, go with the story or to, like, stay in the place of, you know, the witness or whatever. And so I think I had sort of picked up that as a bit of a concept and then felt that, you know, he needs to do better and he needs to be more devoted, he needs to take this more seriously, like...
But where in that instruction to let go of the thought, does it say he or somebody else? In the sense, okay, let me elaborate a bit.
Yeah. No, but I know it's...
So for years I've shared, don't believe your next thought.
Yeah.
Bhagavan said, if there is still a sense of choice, if you still feel like you can do something, make that choice to not follow your stream of thought. You see, Guruji has said this. You see, so he said, if there is still a sense of choice, then use your choice in this way. You see, now once you use it in this way, not to follow the stream of thought, you will see that even this play of going along with the stream of thoughts or not was also just the play of grace, you see, if you want to blame something for it. So, you see, it's like we use these very broad terms to point to things which are undefinable.
Yeah.
You see? So, just so that they seem to have some coherence, you see, but now where we are coming is that we are not so concerned about fitting into like a coherent box of pointing and things like this. You see? So, I feel like we had similar conversation. In fact, when the last time also you came, where this was like this, like, but why can't he just be in the truth or something like that? It's very much like that one going to Guruji. You must have heard this now, saying, "I am clear now that I am not real." You see? But for the life of me, I can't admit that my husband is not real. This kind of thing. So, if you follow Guruji's pointing, which is to say, okay, let go of this thought. If you still feel like you have some choice, let go of this invitation from the mind to give it belief. You see? Then, is there a he left? Is it? So, it is not just that you will see that, I am not the doer, so how can he be?
Yeah.
Is it? Which is also good in a way. Is it? It will also be helpful in the world if we applied it the same way. Is it? But even better is that when you are not going with notions, where is the separation, where is the separate one anyway? So to remain in your notionless existence, to not believe your next thought, to not go with somebody who was saying the other day, I saw on Facebook Maharaj's quote, that the only meditation is to not go with these thoughts. I don't know the exact term that he used, you see. So all the masters are saying the same thing, which is that the only thing that makes us believe in this duality, desire, doership is these thoughts. You see? So the way to cut it from the root is to be empty of your thought this minute, is empty of belief in the thought this minute. Now, without that, where is your boundary? Where do you end and he starts and all these things?
Mm-hmm.
You see, all that is cut from the base only, not just an understanding that if it applies here, it also applies there, which in itself is good, but beyond that even. In fact, that pointing is cannot be for that one which has this boundary anyway.
Yeah.
You see? Because the believer of thoughts is who?
Yeah, I just kind of recognized like more recently that just sort of noticing like that there's so much openness and so much like patience and understanding like when meeting anyone else, because there's no sense of them being else, like there's no sense of them being really other. And then it was just kind of picked up at some point like, oh, but there's still this belief that like my boyfriend, he's really other.
Yeah.
Like he's not me or one, you know. And so that's, yeah. But
everyone has this affliction to some degree.
I've also found that like I've kind of been like wondering about this in a way, because I think sometimes then like spiritual justifications like justify like
his
behavior is often like it's abusive, and it's, you know, like there's a lot of negativity and blame and accusations like thrown onto me for the least kind of trigger, like the really was like very insignificant, and it sort of causes the experience of like there being conflict and drama
So let's look at this. This is a good point. Because we have to look at both sides of it, right? So let me take my box example. In the two sides of the box, in one side of the box we are saying he's responsible for his actions, he's behaving badly. That is one. Second is that he's not, there is no such me or him anyway, so everything is okay.
Mm-hmm.
You see, I'm saying throw both sides away. It is not, if this is not true, doesn't make this true.
Yeah.
Or if this is not true, doesn't make this true. You see? So, meet it empty of both these positions. You see? And I'm tempted in a way because that is also a habit. You see? To say that, then self knows how to meet it or knows how to deal with that situation without having to take a position. But I'm not even going to say that.
Yeah.
You don't have to decide that it is this or that.
Yeah, that's kind of how it's, that's just how it's like unfolded
yeah,
in more
exactly.
recent times. Because for a time it sort of felt like there was still a sense of like needing to make a decision to like continue in the relationship or, you know, being like,
yeah.
no, I can't, you know, this is time, this,
yeah.
I don't want to, this, not necessary to like continue with this.
Exactly.
And now it's just like, I don't really care.
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
but not
so
that, no? In the sense you're just for communication, you're saying that.
Yeah.
In the sense you don't have this position of.
Yeah, like I don't think
yeah.
it's necessary to like make a decision or to know either
yes.
way.
Yes.
And it's not really relevant or
yeah.
like I'm not really
yeah.
interested in
yeah.
that whole.
Now,
thing
so this is what I'm saying. So very slowly we can go on this. Very good. So, like, even these things that you're saying, just because we have to communicate in some way so that we can share about something which is beyond these words, but if you find yourself concluding on any of these like statements, conclusions.
Yeah, I'd say it's more like the absence of any conclusion.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, just.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, exactly. It's just like.
yeah.
So.
And, but also the mind tries to like convince that, but this is really important actually, this needs to be looked at or whatever. And this is like...
Of course it does. And what its meaning of being looked at is to avoid it. So, let me explain that what I mean, you see? So, the minute I conclude hand, I'm no longer looking at it. You see? So there's just, for a moment, let's use some provisional term. So let's say pure perception is happening, you see. Then if I have a term for it, hand, you see, then it's just like, when I was young, I got hurt on my hand, you see, this is the hand, then the Lord has 1,000 hands, you see, so many notions about hands are there. So in that burden of the term, the meeting is actually gone, you see. So when the mind says, we must look at this, actually it's like, let's conclude on something,
okay,
look
story.
At the options, look at the stories and let's conclude on what this really means.
Yeah.
You see? But it doesn't have meaning there. Actually, we've avoided it.
Yeah.
You see? So, and this is something like I'm happy to share over and over again because it can feel like when we are not in the burden of thoughts, you see, the mind itself comes and says, but that is some sort of avoidance. You see? You're avoiding it. No, I'm meeting it. You see, when I label it as if I know what it is, that is when I'm avoiding the pure meeting. You see, that is when I'm just saying, okay, I know what this is hand. You see, I know what this is man. I know what this is partner. I know what this is, you see, all these kind of things. So, how are we then meeting it? You see?
Yeah.
So, this is how most of interaction also happens in the world. Like, often I say that before the person can come close enough to shake your hand, you see, you already put so many labels on that one that you're no longer meeting that, you see? You're no longer meeting, you're just meeting your ideas of who he is, you see? So, it's like, oh, he's going to be like this, he's going to be like that, or he must be a hippie, or he must be a, you see, a sadhu, or he must be, like this kind of thing, you see? So, you're meeting through the filter, through the prism of these labels. That is how we are actually avoiding, you see? So look at the mind's invitation when it says to, but we must meet this, see, or we must really look at this. It's saying we must really avoid it actually.
Yeah.
Because let's label it so that we can claim I know it. Is
yeah,
it?
That feels just like more clear now somehow.
Yes.
And it's like, I don't really know how to describe it, but there's just kind of like a sense that there's never any need to move the attention from what is. Like, that is the best place from which, like, to meet everything. Like, there's no need to ever really, like, go into, like, story, like, to give that
conceptualization
to the mind, or to, like, go into any kind of stories that, like, that is never as productive or as true. Well, there's just no need to go there anymore. Like,
when we see that it doesn't have anything on offer,
no.
See, then we don't visit that shop.
No.
That's just like a simple way of saying it.
Yeah.
It's just that, you know, all the bargains and all the deals are all fraudulent. Or at least, even if not fraudulent, at least like they hold no value.
Yeah, completely. Yeah.
Then,
does that mean that I can discard absolutely everything?
Discard everything in the sense?
Everything.
Whatever can be discarded should be discarded.
Yeah.
Yes, if that includes everything, then
everything.
Everything. Yes. Yeah.
So if something is visible, no, it can't be, but even that I can discard.
Huh?
Yeah.
Huh? See? I want to
but
hear
something
you.
Says
yeah.
inside that it can't be that.
So,
it
but that is also
simple,
something, so discard
like,
it.
Like
yeah.
everything.
Everything. Everything.
Like everything.
Yes.
Everything.
Yes. Yes. Everything. Yeah, this is good. This is what I've been saying actually. This everything. Is it?
Like even this discarding is just
even discarding. And even everything. Yeah. Something nothing, something, everything. Discard everything. Now, I could ask you then, did you also go? Okay? But I don't want you to conclude an answer. Maybe at best you can check. When you discarded everything, did you also go?
Yes. No.
Exactly. Good. That's the best answer. Yes and no. It is not in that box. Very good. Everything that you thought about yourself can go. All your birth, your death, that is gone. You see? Your life, your story, your good things, your bad things, everything is gone. You see? You see? And yet, something. Yeah. This is very good to clarify sometime like this because it gives me an opportunity to reiterate that I'm saying that your notionless existence actually is your notionless existence. Everything, is it? Everything.
So Father, like when...
So doing is a notion, just
yeah.
to connect a little bit to what you're saying. Desire is a notion, duality is a notion. Time is a notion, space is a notion.
So when we say it's a notion, then we can't even have the notion that it's gone. I can't have the notion.
Yeah, then coming, going, because time, I said, all of this can happen only
yeah,
in time.
I'm just saying, like when I also said everything is gone, you said, okay, leave gone as
yeah.
well, in the sense.
Exactly.
Yeah, like you said, gone is also gone. So I'm just connecting it with what you were saying there. It's not as if it was there and now it's gone.
Yeah.
It was just never there to begin with in a sense. Right? I mean, it was something I had this notion.
Yeah, but leave this notion also.
Yes, yeah, so what's up? He's going on trying to
conclude
something.
See,
yeah,
it's
I can
a,
see that.
The mind
need.
Is a conclusion machine.
Yeah.
You see? And even this is a conclusion. You see?
Yeah.
The truth does not rest in this box. You see? Which, like I defined for her, which is the truth is nothing, no, it is not nothing. The truth is something, no, it is not something. The truth is everything, it is not everything. You see, and it's not any of these, all of these, or none of these also. So you cannot conclude the truth. If you think you have found the truth, that thought is not true. So in a way, if we still need an explanation, so what are we really after, in a sense, right? We are after something which must be here now. If it also comes as a result of some steps that I have to take, then it is not the truth that always is. You see? So if I have to think a certain thing, if I have to do a certain thing, or I have to be a certain way to get to the truth, then that is the truth that I am not interested in. I am interested in the truth which is isness, no? So I am interested in the truth which just is. You see? Now, if I have constructed bridges to get to the truth, you see? Then it can make me into believe myself to be something that is apart from the truth. That's why I need a bridge to get to the truth. Whether that bridge is a thought, whether it's a practice, whether it is whatever it is, you see? So in the notion of the bridge is the idea of my separation from the truth. So in a way, the only bridge then is to burn the bridge. You see? That is why it is deconstructed. You see? To construct would be to build a bridge to get to the truth. So, but because it seemed like I still need a bridge, then I'm giving you the bridge which is burn the bridge. You see? Which is also a bridge. It doesn't need to be done. But if it feels like something has to be, in a sense, if it feels like we have a choice, burn the bridge. You see, whatever bridge you have to get to the truth, burn the bridge, that is the bridge.
Some separation anxiety I'm doing.
Separation anxiety?
Like
swimming. Same old?
It's when you said that I had to locate the bridge seemingly.
What did you find?
This one. The ideas, the notions that of me.
Yes.
That's what it focused on.
Yeah. And if you burn those, then? And it's very simple what I'm saying. I'm saying, do you need a bridge to sit where you're sitting now? Don't need a bridge to sit where you're sitting now. What is more primal to you than sitting?
Being.
What is more primal to you than being? That is what you're looking for, apparently. You see? So if you don't even need a bridge or any steps to sit where you're sitting now, how to build a bridge to that which is even more intimate? Now, what series of steps can I give you? What truth can I speak that will bring you to this? I wish I could speak the truth.
You're saying it's just about not believing the thoughts.
Yeah. Yes. And seeing that even that is a thought ultimately. Provisionally, that's what, as long as it feels like there is a choice, make the choice not to go with the stream of thought, but then to see that even that seeming choice was just a play of grace. I'm quoting, paraphrasing Bhagwan.
and that seeing that it was not a choice is not like
a choice.
A waiting.
Not a waiting.
It's actually clear in the first statement you're saying.
Very good. Very good point. Slash conditioning. You see? The way... Why is this saying internet connection? Antennas are perfect. Okay, so what is the question? Can our direct seeing also be influenced by our previous learning, leaning / conditioning? Direct seeing is the way the term is used in satsang here, is that it is independent of conditioning. That's the point of it being direct, means it is not through the filter of our ideas, filter of our notion. You see? It is meeting what is as what is, but even those are terms. So direct seeing is not dependent on that. So when I ask you, for example, are you aware now? If you're answering from a previous inference or a previous insight from memory, then I'll keep asking you over and over, saying, look now, are you aware now? And then when you say yes, then where does that, it is that direct that it is not even a perception. You see? How to say like that? That seeing which is so direct that it is not even a perception, because you are not having a perception of awareness. You see? So, conditioning would mean that you have a notion of it, a term for it, you are meeting an inference about it. That would be to meet it as, are you aware now? Of course I'm aware, because it says in Ashtavakra Gita chapter 3 verse 17, you are boundless awareness in which the arcs of the universe come and go. You see? So that would be to infer it, you see, through either some previous insight we have had or we've heard from some credible source like the sages. You see? That would be that. Second would be to say, I saw it, of course, awareness is sitting there. You see? It is deep blue in color. You see, like that would be a perception of it. You see, but this is the one thing you say yes to without having to infer it or having the perception of it. It is that direct that it is beyond even perception. You see, so it is independent of previous anything actually, previous conditioning, previous insight, any previous story. Father, if there is no doer and we have no tools to control action, is there anyone to be blamed for succumbing to habitual tendencies, and who can do anything if such tendencies continue? Then there is nobody left. No doer is only because there is nobody. It is not because there is a somebody, but he or she is not the doer. This is the main point. It is not that there is a somebody. Now we have stripped that somebody of the of its power of doing or not doing. You see? It is that there is nobody like that. You see? That is found. You see? Yes. So, does that now mean... So that's why the discussion with Joy was relevant. Was saying that, should I make that position, oh, you are doing so much, why are you doing this to me, you see, in our struggles in our relationships, to saying, oh, but he's not the doer anyway, you see, I should forgive him because I'm not the doer, same way he's not the doer. But these are both in that conceptual box, you see, and neither of these positions will help you, will help anyone, you see, because if you're making a position out of anything, you're limiting yourself, you're still creating a version about yourself who has a belief system in which is like this. You see, your unlimited self is beyond any of this constriction. You see, That's what I'm saying, rather than figuring out who is the doer or not, you see, explore whether there is something called doing itself. You see, how does a sensation or a perception, how do we label that a doing? Birds are not doing that apparently, and they are fine. You see, little babies are not doing that, and they are fine. You see? I would say often, no, that baby doesn't come out of the womb and say, ah, I'm here, you see, what's my first move? Ah, I have to cry, yes, yes, cry, yeah, it's not like that, you see. They have no idea of do or not do. This is our notional knowledge, you see, our notional ideas then make us into these limited objects, make us feel like we are these limited objects. So don't try to figure out whether you are the doer or you are not the doer. Figure out who you are if you have to figure out something. And I can also tell you that you can't figure it out. In the sense that, not that there is no hope, I'm just saying you can't use this device of intellect to solve this puzzle. And you cannot use the devices of perception to solve this puzzle. So, this figuring out is not intellectual, this figuring out is not perceptual. And the more you figure out in that way, the more of a burdened spiritual seeker slash spiritual ego you will nurture.
I just wanted to add that I love like what you're saying on this point, that like it's to limit, because it's so clear that like touching any idea, like either of those boxes, like the, you know, to continue or to not or whatever, like it's not just that idea, then it comes with the whole thing, or it's just been clearly seen like in more recent times, oh, but then to believe in that then like creates the sense of like an individual, that there's really an individual entity living in this world. And that really it has a life, and that it really has relationships, and that there really is a world, like, and everything is like bum 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 bum, like so quickly, like stuck
exactly.
onto just that little thing. And so it's so clear, like when that is seen, that it, like, that just that none of that can be true, and it makes it easy also to like discard it, I
discard,
guess.
Yes, discard.
And,
not,
and it's so
but
clear,
not going
like,
from this to this or this to this.
Yeah, I mean, of course, like, you can't really describe it in any way, but it feels like it's everything.
Yes.
And then to try to, like, to pick up one thing is to go, and then believe that, like, this is somehow an accurate representation of it.
Exactly, exactly.
You know? And it's just,
This is good to see, very good insight, because I sometimes say like that, you say one term and you say the whole dictionary actually.
Yeah.
In the sense that, tell me something which is independent. Some notion which is independent of every other notion. It is not, you see. You say God, you have 10,000 notions about that, and each of those notions have 10,000 notions about that, and each of those have 10,000 notions. You say man, you have 10,000 notions about that, we have 10,000 notions about each of those notions that. You see? So you pick up one tiny idea saying that, ah, this has to be quite harmless. You see? And ta-da! You tug at one leaf, it seems like, ah, this could actually be useful. But then you pick up this entire notional world, you see? That's why Pankaj said the unborn. He didn't say the, like, the little bit born. You can't, like, pick up one idea and say, you see? This one seems kind of safe. You see, because in that idea, even the thorns which are being used to remove other thorns are contained all the ideas in the universe.
Yeah. And on that point as well, like, it's been noticed, or it was noticed at some point, like, there was still a tendency to cling to the pointers, to cling to, like, you know, just a few, like, spiritual concepts or whatever. And it's like such an avoidance to just really be naked, like just zero, zero, empty, empty. And like, and while, like, they can be, you know, they seem to be, like, helpful over time, the pointers, like, clinging to any pointer, like, is it necessarily then comes with the implied assumption or idea that, like, there's a seeker, that there really is a seeker,
yeah.
that there really is distance, and that there really is a journey, and all of this,
all
like, just
this,
with one innocent
one,
pointer.
Exactly.
And yeah, of course, I think it's, I'm sure, like, you know, most beings experience that hesitance to, like, really let go of everything, but it's like it's really the only way, like, and including, you know, the one who lets go,
yeah.
like
yeah.
just
yeah. That's why I feel like some of Bhagwan's metaphors are very, very poignant in a way. Is that the right word? Poignant?
Mm-hmm.
No.
Poignant.
Like when he says thorn, you see, used to remove other thorns, but thorn also implies that that can hurt you as well.
Yeah.
You see, so. Even if you have the greatest thorn, if you think that that is it, that if that gets embedded, that will also hurt you. You see? So the only use of the concept in satsang, which is all just concepts and ultimately all nonsense, you see? At least for the, I can say for satsang that is shared from here, you see? It's all complete nonsense. If there is a point, the point is only that it can help to remove or help to deconstruct whatever seems too true. Is it? Whatever seems too true, that is looked at and we find that, okay, but that is not true at all, it's just a thought. Is it? So if we come for confirmation of, okay, I found this to be true, is it? And then, like conceptually or notionally about anything, and you're expecting the master to say, yes, yes, that notion is completely valid, is it? Then even if that kind of reassurance is coming from time to time, it is going to be provisional. It is going to be temporary, you see. Because like I said, there is no bridge because you are it. But even that is like a bridge. You see? Anything that we can communicate, you see. Unless it's dissolving this tyranny of language itself, you see, then it's not deconstructive, really. We're deconstructing the bridges which take us to an apparent truth, you see. But what are bridges made up of? Truth is always here. Then why you need a bridge? You see? I must always just be like this, but it always is, no? You see? So, this is the suffering of a spiritual seeker, because the concepts are made up of such beautiful pointers, you see? But buying into that notion, you're still considering yourself to be a limited entity to try and get to something.
There seems to be a recognition of awareness of what is, but still, as you pointed it beautifully, the thoughts are still believed in when they are arising and when they are said. So
thoughts are still believed in. So. You will find that you want to get into the mechanics of that?
Yes.
Or,
okay. No.
Okay.
I don't mind. The
yeah.
thing
yeah.
I would like to is
yeah.
not to believe in the thoughts I'm
yeah.
having.
Yeah. Don't believe in the I. But
to who are you talking to? You
don't believe in the you also.
It's a genuine question, you know.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm genuine answer. So don't believe in between I and you. Instead of believing what this I should be or should not be doing, you see, don't believe in the I itself, or you for that matter.
There is some resistance.
Yeah.
I don't know, I see forms and instantly.
So that, don't believe in the eye that sees. And what it sees. Like forget what is forms and resistance. Don't know what anything is. Because you don't know it.
Yeah, the thought is coming.
Yeah.
How can there be even forgetting? You know, how is it?
Yeah. So, forget that even this is a thought. Like, what is thought? More terms, and those will have more terms, and those will have more terms. You see, so it's every notion contained that. Come to the innocence of a child. Thought, no thought, you, me, I, this, that. Like a child doesn't know what is thought, what is mind. Is it struggling? A bird doesn't know what is a thought. Is it struggling? Who was I quoting the other day? Yeah, Wittgenstein. He said, the only solution to the problem of life is to see that there is no problem of life. That which we are trying to solve, that which we are trying to get to, itself is completely made up. You see? And that it is made up is also made up. In the sense, we are not to take the position of, oh, all this is rubbish. You know? Even that is just made up. We give up on everything that is made up. We don't know what anything is. We just have terms for things. And really we always know what everything is, in reality, but we don't have the term for that. No term. Does any term represent what is? Like mind, thought, I, you, me, other, world, body, consciousness, awareness, self, guru, disciple. Just terms, they don't mean anything at all. But as spiritual seekers, we have made idols to these terms in a way. So everything. Tell me something you actually know. Like if you were in a spiritual movement which said that the point of what we are doing every day is to create this sensation which at the moment you have labeled resistance, then that would come and you would call it phantasmo or something. Ah, Father, thank you. So much Fantasimo is coming. Is it? Is it? But we don't know. Hey, Guruji has this beautiful example, you see, where he says that if you're going to be speaking on stage and if you have stage fright or something like that, you see, you feel like, oh, I'm so nervous, I don't like this. But if you look at just the sensation and you look at it, so I have this anxiety or something, you see, and then similar or actually same sensation when you're going on a holiday and saying, oh, I'm so excited, I'm so happy, so in the energetic spectrum, do we really know what is what? You see? If I propose to you that you never experience the same thing twice, you see? And yet our labels are just the same limited ones, you see? Yeah, you see? Then how would we look at it? You see? Do we even remember what we experienced? We just remember the label of it. You see? Something was experienced today. You see, ah, today I was so angry. You see? But do you remember the real taste of it? And when tomorrow if that comes, can you really conclude? Can we really conclude that it was the same? We just build the story around the terms that we use, around our idea of what we think we know. There's nothing ultimately called perception also, and through ultimately also. In fact, the word ultimately in spirituality is a great postponing. Because Maharaj said, all the truth that I can speak is that I am. You see? But ultimately, even that is not true. You see? And then when we hear this ultimately, we forget even that is not true because we defer it. No, it's ultimately. Tab ki tab dekhenge, you know? Mm-hmm. When that when that happens, we'll see. You see? But that's why.
You're saying in the sense it appears and disappears, or
what? I'm saying this is the term ultimately is like a postponing. He's saying I am is also not true. You see? So.
Because it appears and disappears.
No, no inference. It is just see. The any reference to I is not true, even that I am. The I thought, whatever the color of the I thought may be, is just I thought.
Actually, my question was not related to I am,
okay.
It was related to perception. Just
perception. What is perception?
I don't know if it is... like in the dream, there were... Now there are, so don't know which one is real or which one, but there is an appearance.
What is an appearance? So you'll have like, what is the perception? It's an appearance. What's an appearance? It's a perception. You see, it's like circular. You see? Now, Does any of these terms actually define what is?
No, the term doesn't.
So that what is indescribable, you see? But when we try to contain it in like our intellectual framework, conceptual frameworks, you see? Then we can only build these castles in the air using that. You see? So, if what you're calling perception, does that need the term perception? That doesn't need it. Then what does?
To convey.
To convey is kind of okay, but to understand, you see? This is what you have to look at, to know. That I know what something is because I understand now that this is just a perception or just an appearance. But we don't really know anything that way. We know everything another way, which is neglected when we try to know something this way. You see? We know everything another way, but that is neglected when we try to know anything this way, actually.
So, it just occurred to me that earlier there was, like you said, forget I.
Forget I, yes.
Forget you, and those terms when forget what there is something called doing,
yes.
Then that got replaced with there is just perception.
Yes, this is what I was saying, but even that we have to look at and say, do we really know? Perception implies perceiver, perceived, perceiving. These three terms are already included in that. You see? But nothing like that we know. You see? In our knowing or attempt to know conceptually, we miss the truth that is apparent. We miss the truth that is apparent. You see? And my whole feeling is to introduce you to this, which is apparent. You see? It is wordless. Which is not opposed to words. Words can come and go also. But in our building, trying to build that sand castle, the ocean gets missed. And the sand castle is built on the foundation of the I thought. Any reference you make to I. And like little children, we might feel like building that sandcastle, we might feel like, if I can only relate I to the absolute, I'm really then done. You see? I am Brahman, I am the absolute. But the term itself is full of duality. You see, Ribhu said it, don't take my word for it. You can get away from the duality even of I am Brahman. You see? Because anything that you assert in that way negates something, creates a limited box, whether you can see it yet or no.
So automatically implies that there's something apart from Brahman.
Exactly. Even the dichotomy of ego versus Brahman, persons versus self, you see, all of these are just boundaries. And nothing holds up to one moment of open inquiry. You see, look at any notion, even though you may have it for 10 years, if you look at it with little bit of openness, you'll see it's nonsense. It's just made up. You see? Just made up. And it can be very strange because we have a library full of books, you see. But when you read, what is the intent of those books? Adhyaropa Apavada, which is to make a provisional truth to take you away from what is deeply embedded, you see. And then to empty you of that provisional truth as well. Not to leave you with that idea, you see. Which is the method of Vedanta, is to say, in a way, let me paraphrase, so what you believe yourself to be, this object with two hands and two feet, you are that absolute, you are that who has all the hands and feet are yours, you see, like that, you are that. Because all the hands and feet are yours, you see? And then you don't have hands or feet. You see? Where does that leave you? You see? It took you away from this limited object idea of being contained in this meat bucket to a broader notion which dissolves your prior notion, but that itself also has to be dissolved. So it is not that, so do I have hands and feet, all of them or none of them, or what is, you see, it is not concludable that way. You see, now how to make a teaching like that? You see, because if I say nothing is concludable, you make a conclusion out of that. You see, that's why the method of Vedanta is to negate something through an assertion, then negate the assertion itself and leave you empty of anything to hold on to. Same for Zen, same for any of these. If you meet these problems with your mind, the goose problem, a baby goose fell into a priceless vase, which is a national artifact or something. You see? Now, if you try to fly out, then the wings would, the top is too small. You see? So the villagers were compassionate, or people in the palace, they were compassionate, kept feeding the goose. You see? Now the goose has come to this size where if it eats anymore, it'll suffocate in the vase. It's grown now, you see? And the vase won't be broken. So how will you get the goose out? Very useful koan. Very useful koan. Meet it and see where you define the limits. See your limits of can, cannot. That's all the clues I'm going to give you. It is not to say, ah, yeah, I know, but no, no goose, no vase. It is not like, you will work with these for 20 years. It's not just like you can, so it's like, ah, actually, in reality, no goose, no vase. It is not a notional riddle in that way.
When you said in the Veda, that father thing, so it's to, whether I have two hands.
Sound is gone, or back, oh, okay. No,
two hands or 10 hands, and it's not to know whether you have 2 or 10, but is it also not to just to bring you to the thing that there is no you in a sense?
No.
No. I'm just checking again.
In the sense that it is not to bring you to anything that you can conceptually see. You see? It is not, that might be the provisional. So if you are so caught up in the idea of an individual you,
mm-hmm.
you see, that there is no you. You see? But then if that makes you into something which is obsessed with the idea there is no me, you see, that is also not the perspective. Or you feel like now I know there is no me. You see? Which is also full of contradictions.
Yeah,
it is
exactly.
Not.
So it's full of contradictions in that sense. So if it's to say, like once you had explained to me that. It's like you,
so let's pause here for a moment, you see, because I just said that we cannot know it that way, you see.
Yeah.
And in our attempt to know it that way, that which is known just so organically, primally, here and now, immediately, that seems to get obscured. You see? So, what is the attempt now? Is it to know more? No. My answer will help in doing what? Your question is a request to get what? Is it to deconstruct or to construct?
To deconstruct.
Okay, deconstruction happened, done. Now?
Like
you know this?
No, I
don't paint any picture.
Okay.
As if the mind can understand. Everything that I am also speaking is just nonsense. It's provisional at best. Don't conclude anything.
So I just leave it then. When you once said, I can't perceive it and I don't need to go with the mind, and it was deeply recognized that. And then when we continue to see this and
yes,
this and this,
that's
my
have
mind
to,
wants
exactly,
to keep going in that direction.
Exactly.
Again,
that's why I have to keep giving that reminder that this
yeah,
is
yeah.
just the acid.
Yeah,
clean
so
up.
It's just
is
becoming,
it?
You know, like,
yeah.
I'm again going with the words to see the
yeah.
conclusion.
So hear them as reminders of the same thing,
okay.
rather than now as an invitation to build on what you understand.
Yeah.
Is
okay.
it? Because that's all it is. It's just a reminder to that,
okay.
is it? Rather than to now give you a new understanding. Is it? And sometimes when I try to explain to you, okay, this is what is the method of Vedanta, or this is what, it's just to, because I know that in our weak moments we are full of doubt, see? So if you have these reassurances, sometimes it can just feel better that, okay, I'm not, completely deluding myself, see, it's not, I'm not being, not on the wrong track or something. More and more it unfolds, I'm reading now. Sometimes in the transcript I notice that the transcriber doesn't realize that I'm reading from the screen, so it's still attributed to Ananta or this mouth. So maybe I should say, the more and more it unfolds, it seems that the very process of inquiry, as I call it, is a form of psychological defense. The notion that I'm inquiring seems to lose its vigor. There is a kind of silence around. We keep asking you how to gallop the horse. We are even ready to give up galloping, but we are deeply stuck when you remind us, no horse, no galloping, pranam. Is it? Can feel like that. Someone also asked me the other day, so how to send questions to you, because we don't see them on the chat. So some of the questions come on private chat. That's how I read them. There's no other mechanism to send questions. It's just the private chat. Which is fine, because I take that to mean that you don't want to ask openly in the chat, or it's also nice in a way that in a sense that if it is not addressed in satsang, then it doesn't, others don't have to take on additional questions that that they may not have. Oh, that's so good. Let me take that question.
Can I say something from experience?
Yeah.
That you said that anything can be doubted. The witness of perception cannot be doubted.
So that's Descartes. In a sense, that's what the discovery he came to also. That even if there is a doubt, that there is doubting happening, you see, and I am witnessing that. That is undoubtable, you see, in a way, that's what he was trying to communicate. That whatever the content of the thought may be, you see, I have to conclude that I am perceiving these thoughts and therefore I am, you see. I am just inviting you to see that even that inferring doesn't need to be done. And even that conclusion doesn't have to be made.
It is.
What is that it? That it is super apparent before you can conclude anything about it. Before you can make it into knowledge, it just is. So meet this one without any mask of concept, without any mask of knowing. This is the meeting we've been waiting for. There's no way to do it. There's no way to not do it. Nothing can be really spoken about it. Nothing is true or false about it. And actually, you cannot abide in it or leave it. All of these are also just pointers.
Can I ask you?
Yes.
It's like a kind of knowingness.
But not this knowingness. Yes. And even that is just provisional. See? It's just for communication.
It's true of abiding in it too.
Exactly. Provisional.
Provisional.
Exactly.
And you can't be separate from it also.
The entire box is provisional. With all the opposites. See? With all the claims and the counterclaims. So satsang is like this sort of clearance sale. Everything must go. Everything must go. Although it's a place of rest.
Rest, home, whatever you can call it. But from there you can, you know, I mean the unfolding happens then.
Now, if you didn't know this, would it affect it in any way? That if you didn't know it was a place of rest, and you didn't know it was home, and you didn't know it is from where unfolding will happen. See? In a way, like I was saying the other day, that will chocolate lose its taste if you don't have the term chocolate? Will the perfume lose their fragrance if you don't know this is celestial? What is it? Celestial?
Gateway.
Child is eating a chocolate. It is not enjoying because it is, I am eating chocolate. It's not enjoying the notion that I am eating the chocolate. The world is being tasted independent of the idea of world and taste. Anantaji, even though it has been seen that these thoughts are imagination, just daydreams, still they grasp my attention for a few moments until again it is seen as a dream. Anything that can be done in this regard? It's already quite good. Just to notice is all that is needed in a way. There is no other tool, like you cannot shovel it out or something. It's just to... The noticing of it is enough. And often we don't even realize that we are relating to I. Yeah. It's like we don't know how much we still know. You see, you have a sense of what is being said there, right? In the sense that how much we still are taking to be like, obviously this is true, like he can't be speaking about this, is it? Like it can feel like, okay, he's speaking at another level. No, I'm actually speaking about everything that we think we know, is it? But we still can have these like blind spots in a way. You see, we still feel like, but it's on top of this, everything that I know is not true. You see, but it's still true that I have to live this life, or you know, something. So we still have some notion that we feel like, but everything excluding that, you see, is what he's talking about. But then it comes, no, even that. That's why she's saying very beautiful. Everything. everything. Clear and sale. Everything must go. Because our idea of individuality, the notion of me, has relied on these slightest, and we looked at this in great detail, where we said we pick up one term and you pick up every term. You pick up one notion and you pick up every notion. No notion is independent. Everything is related to everything else, notionally. That's why I keep reiterating these days, this is nonsense, this is provisional, this is not some to be set in stone. In the same way, the Guruji says, don't make tattoos out of my words. Same thing. If all that happens after coming to satsang for whatever period of time you're coming is that you replace some old notion with new ones, you see, then it's been quite pointless. If you just said, I came into satsang thinking that I am individually the doer, but now I know God is the doer. I've not done my job, you see. I've not done my job. It's still here, you see, still here. You are Ribhu's Gita made flesh. Thank you, my love. Made fresh also, no? I love you and thank you. Thank you, my dear. Thank you. Guruji, as long as I'm limiting myself with sense perceptions, I'm bound. How do I break this barrier? You can never limit yourself with sense perception. Is it? You can only limit yourself with notions. In the perception itself, how will you try to limit yourself with the sense perception? You see, you only limit yourself with, I don't want that sense perception, or I want that sense perception. You see, so these are notions that are applied on top of just what is being perceived. So it is not the perception itself. In fact, I call them pure perception. This pure perception itself, notable. It is that mixed with our idea of it, which is either pulling, pushing, taking a position, you see, which is the limiting factor, which is how you consider yourself to be an object itself. You see. So, we must drop this notion, you see, that we get limited by what we see or what we hear or what we taste. You see, that cannot limit us, because no separation is inherent in that. Our limitation only comes with our labels, our terms, our saying I want, I don't want, desire, aversion, all of these ideas. So then you don't have to go hiding from the world. That, oh, my attention should not go here, my attention should not go there, it should only be like this, it should only be like that. It is none of that. You see? Open. It is free, but you are not limiting, you are not putting on this mask, you see, which can never truly obscure you, but it can seem to obscure your reality, your limiting idea about yourself. So the difference between, in reality, between the unborn, as Bankai would call it, and the born, which is just a notional idea of yourself, is just a thought. You see? There is nothing fundamentally that changed. You see? But in this play it can seem like, oh, it's a big problem. So I'm like the doctor who's solving like the no problem problem. Like the, what are those diseases called? I'm the doctor who's offering the placebo. Because you're not really ailing with anything. You are beyond all these things in reality. But your ailment can seem real to you. And that is why whatever is spoken here is just provisional, for as long as that your ailment seems real. And you see that your ailment itself is not real, then there is no use of any of this. It is not meant to be known for that purpose. You see? It's like you need the medicine only if you feel that you have the ailment. Like, again, to say what Wittgenstein said, he said, the only solution to the problem of life is to see that there is no problem. So once you see that there is no problem, what am I seeking? You see, what is the seeker's problem? He's not getting what he's seeking. What are you seeking? You see, what is it that you're seeking? When you say myself, but what are you then? You see, there is no problem. And once you see that there is no problem, then that ailment goes away. You see? Now, you can't think all this. Like, the thinking that I think that there is no problem. I used to think there is a problem, now I think there is no problem, it doesn't solve the problem. You see, you have to see it, but you have to see it with not these eyes, with a different set of eyes. You see? You have to see it non-perceptually. You see? So my job in Satsang is to show you, but I cannot show these eyes. You see? I'm showing you. But if you expect to see it, then it is not it. I am showing you. But if you expect to see it, then it is not it. And don't take on problems that you don't have. In the sense that sometimes, like even like this, if I'm saying, I'm showing you, but if you expect to see it, then it is not it. You see, you didn't have that problem. It is, you heard it, that he's saying, if I'm expecting to see it, it is, yeah, I am expecting to see it. Now, how unfair of him to, yeah, like this, he can get into, it's not that way. I'm just saying that the expectation is in time. Expectation is awaiting, you see, it is more immediate, you see, but these words then can hear like, oh, I still have the problem of expectation, that's not what I'm saying, you see, I think, okay. Before the ta-da, before any experience can come that will confirm this truth, before any notion can come which you can claim, is it? Is it? I'm showing you. And whose sleep was it? Very good point. So you say, in deep sleep, I don't know, I exist. You see? So the one who doesn't know that they exist is which one? You see? That is what we are discovering in the waking state. That's all this is actually. I say to 10,000 different things, that's all this is. I'm aware of this.
I exist.
But before you can know you exist, you know. You see? The clue is in that itself. You see? Before you can know, and whatever that knowing is, including the knowing that I exist, you have to know. You see? So that knowing is what? That is the whole thing. That same knowing is there in deep sleep. Okay, now I'm saying too much, but yeah. The same knowing.
Say again.
See, even to say All I really know is that I exist. You see, so you, I know I exist. So that knowledge that I exist, you see, needs that I know part first. That knowledge of I exist and I don't exist, that goes, comes and goes. But that I know part does not, whether it is sleep, otherwise you would not be able to report
yes,
on sleep. You see?
Yes, yes.
So that knowing is what? Is it conceptual? Is it perceptual?
No.
This is what you're talking about.
So that's what.
But if I keep saying this stuff, it will become conceptual. You see? That's why these days I'm not saying so much of that, because you will say, I am that same one who's in my deep sleep. You will become a pandit about that. You see? And then that'll have to be deconstructed. You see? Then I'll have to find some other tool to clean you up of that.
So the concept is broken, actually.
Yes.
So this is a breaking of the concept.
Exactly.
Thank you. Because you always referring to a concept, you know.
Yeah.
Is that it? Is that it? Really?
Yeah.
Now since you are telling, it's clear. Yeah. Thank you.
Can I ask you something?
Yeah.
When you say conceptual,
yeah,
you mean anything which comes and goes, like Aditya? Is that conceptual?
No, conceptual means anything that you can put in language, put in terms.
So comfort, discomfort,
yeah,
suffering,
yeah,
happiness.
All terms.
It's all conceptual.
Yes.
Bad situations, abuse.
Yes, all of these are terms. Good situation.
Yeah.
Is it also? Yeah. All the opposites.
Yeah.
All the opposites are
but
terms.
Anything which doesn't let you rest in the self or peace or whatever that
even rest and self.
Yeah. So you will get away from those situations and not really.
Even get away and situation.
Or you will not stay in it saying it's good for my spiritual advancement or whatever.
Even stay and not stay.
Hmm.
You see? Because who can really predict? You see? We don't like really know any of this in reality. So, all our representations, all that we think that this is, you see, is conceptual. You see? Now, I want to say ultimately like Maharaj, but ultimately, even what this is conceptual. You see? Whether you call it the manifest or you call it appearance, or you call it perception.
Yeah, birth and death is also.
Exactly. It's a useful contemplation. Will you experience death? You see? And if you will experience death, if you won't experience death, then it's nothing to worry about anyway. You see, because you will not experience it. If you will experience it, then you are beyond that. If you are still around to experience that, then also nothing to worry about. Because it did not kill you, you are still there. So it's just a fancy notion. Like in this world, when we say mostly all these invitations to help the planet, all these fall on deaf ears because somebody says in 2500 years this world will not have water, and we say what? They will deal with it in 2000. You see? So some of us will say, oh, our children have to feel like this kind of thing. So you see, now the panic is starting to set in, because it's like, now you see, like your children or your before you die, you will not have water then. Okay, now come on, shut down all this pollution. You see? So, you see? So, but for death also you can do the same thing. You will not experience it. You see? If you are not there in death, then you will not experience it. Don't bother. And if you will experience it, then you didn't die anyway. What's there to be concerned about?
Just a couple
cycle of things,
yeah.
there's a quote saying like, then I am there, death is not there.
Yeah.
And death is there, I am not there.
Yeah.
So I need not worry about
death.
This one thing. The second thing is like, before your date of birth, you were not there. So death is something you have already experienced.
Yeah.
So.
Like Maharaj. Sounds a bit like Maharaj would say. Yeah.
I heard it
yeah.
from
Super. Exactly.
What is death? Like after
that
day, you are not
birth.
Dead. So death of before your birth.
Before you were born, you were dead.
Yeah.
You know it the same way, before or after. It reminded me in business terms. There was a management guru, was it Jim Collins, somebody who said, in the long run, everybody's dead. Yes, same as we don't know how much we know. Thank you, thank you, thank you. The hypnosis, yes, yes, yes. Ghost and mantras to remove, I don't know the context of that. Thank you, mothers. This hint that I know that I exist, you cannot think about the first part. I know. Good, good. Yeah. You can do some Ripu Gita chanting on. Of Sri Ramakrishna. This is page 403. So the master is saying, now and then I reflect on these ideas and find that I do not like them. In the beginning of a spiritual life, a man should think about sin and how to get rid of it. But when, through the grace of God, devotion an ecstatic lover awakened in his heart, then he altogether forgets virtue and sin. Then he leaves the scriptures and their injunctions far behind, just before we chant. Thoughts of repentance and penance do not bother him at all. It is like going to your destination along a winding river. This requires great effort and a long time, but when there is flood all around, then you can go straight to your destination in a short time. Then you find the land lying under water deep as a bamboo pole. In the beginning of spiritual life, one goes about a roundabout way. One has to suffer a great deal, but the path becomes very easy when ecstatic love is awakened in the heart. It is like going over the paddy field after the harvest is over. You may then walk in any direction. Before the harvest, you had to go along the winding bulk, but now you can walk in any direction. There may be stubble in the field, but you will not be hurt by it if you walk with your shoes on, just so an aspirant does not suffer if he has dispassion and faith in the Guru's words. Then the questioner asked him, well, what is the rule for concentration? Where should one concentrate? The master said, the heart is a splendid place. One can meditate there or in the Sahasrara, is that how we call it?
Sahasrara Chakra.
These are rules for meditation given in the scriptures. But you may meditate wherever you like. Every place is filled with Brahman consciousness. Is there any place where it does not exist? Narayana, in Valli's presence, covered with two steps, the heavens, the earth, and the interspaces. Is there any place left uncovered by God? A dirty place is as holy as the banks of the Ganges. It is said that the whole creation is the Virat, the universal form of God. There are two kinds of meditation, one on the formless God and the other with the God with form. But meditation on the formless God is extremely difficult. In that meditation, you must wipe out all that you see or hear. You contemplate only on the nature of your inner self. Meditating on his inner self, Shiva dances about. He exclaims, what am I? What am I? This is called Shiva Yoga. While practicing this form of meditation, one directs one's look to the forehead. It is meditation on the nature of one's inner self after negating the world, following the Vedantic method of Niti Neti. There is another form of meditation called the Vishnu Yoga. The eyes are fixed on the tip of the nose. Half the look is directed inward and the other half outward. Okay, this is my main now pointing. This is how one meditates on God with form. Sometimes Shiva meditates on God with form and dances. At that time he exclaims, Ram, Ram, and dances about. Sri Ramakrishna then explained the word Om and the true knowledge of Brahman and the state of mind after the attainment of Brahmajnana. Okay. The sound Om is Brahman. The rishis and sages practice austerity to realize that sound, Brahman. After attaining perfection, one hears the sound of this eternal word rising spontaneously from the navel. What will you gain, some sages ask, by merely hearing the sound? You hear the roar of the ocean from a distance. By following the roar, you can reach the ocean. As long as there is a roar, there must be the ocean. By following the trail of Om, you attain Brahman, of which the word is the symbol. That Brahman has been described by the Vedas as the ultimate goal. But such vision is not possible as long as you are conscious of your ego. A man realizes Brahman only when he feels neither I nor you, neither one nor many. Think of the sun and 10 jars filled with water. The sun is reflected in each jar. At first, you see one real sun and 10 reflected ones. If you break 9 of the jars, there will remain only the real sun and one reflection. Each jar represents a jiva. Following the reflection, one can find the real sun. Through the individual soul, one can realize the supreme soul. Through spiritual discipline, the individual soul can get the vision of the supreme soul. What remains when the last jar is broken cannot be described. Beautiful line. What remains when the last jar is broken cannot be described. The jiva at first remains in the state of ignorance. He is not conscious of God, but of the multiplicity. He sees many things around him. On attaining knowledge, which is capital K, he becomes conscious of God, dwells in all beings. Suppose a man has a thorn in the sole of his foot. He gets another thorn and takes out the first one. In other words, he removes the thorn of Ajnana, ignorance, by means of the thorn of Jnana, knowledge. But on attaining Vijnana, he discards both thorns, knowledge and ignorance. Then he talks intimately with God, day and night. It is no mere vision of God. He has He who has merely heard of milk is ignorant. He who has seen milk and has knowledge. He who has seen milk and has knowledge. But he who has drunk milk and been strengthened by it has attained vijnana. Amen. So, when you hear terms which may seem a little bit different from satsang terms and all, it doesn't bother, it shouldn't bother you because it's okay. You see, it's all terms anyway. But what the sages are pointing to is pretty much the same. He said they may seem like they're manifesting in 1,000 jars and all those 1,000 are broken, only one is left, and you can feel like that is the darshan of the Lord in a way. You see, the individual meets the whole. You see, and there's that which happens, or that what happens when the last jar is also broken. That is indescribable. Is it? Indescribable. So, very beautiful pointer. Also, he said in the middle, like we were saying today, forget the I and you. Many. And he said, if you follow the trail of the individual I, it will lead you to the whole. Is it? So, ask who am I? And it will lead you to the so called destination. Like Guruji says, you no longer trip over words. When your mind is no longer looking for differences and distinctions, then these things all seem like they're pointing to the same. When we're looking for differences and say, but that is this, but we just said like that, then it can seem a bit strange. I also have to go to work today. I have a meeting at 3. So then you girls, you just remind me, I also have to go.
Okay.
What are we reading? You decide. Pick any page.
Chapter 26.
Not bored of it. What is the number? Page number?
4332.
Is it okay, 26, or you want something else?
Huh?
You want something else?
No, it's good. Let's all try a bit, even if you make mistake.
Yeah.
It's okay.
सच्चिदानन्दम् स्वभावं सर्वदा सुखम् सर्ववेदपुराणानां सारात् सारतरं स्वयम्
रिभु आई शाल् एक्स्प्लेन् द एक्सिस्टेन्स् कान्शियस्नेस् सुप्रीम् ब्लिस् विच् इस् एवर् जाय् बै इट्स् ओन् वर्च्यू. It is by itself the core of the essence of all the Vedas and the Puranas.
Na Vedam cha dvayam dvandam, na Vedam veda varjitam, idam eva param brahma, jnanashrayam anamayam.
There is no difference, duality, or pairs of opposites. No difference, and nothing devoid of differences. This alone is Supreme Brahman, afflictionless and attainable by knowledge. Actually, this verse itself is a very, very strong atomic pointer. There is no difference, duality, or pairs of opposite characters. So when they say opposite characters, don't worry about the characters. Just there is no difference, duality, or pairs of opposites. No difference and nothing devoid of differences. You see, This alone is Supreme Brahman, afflictionless and attainable by knowledge.
Na kvachinnat evaham, na ksharam na paratparam, idameva param brahma, jnanashrayamanamayam.
There is nowhere anything as this alone am I, nothing that is decayless, nothing beyond the beyond. This alone is Supreme Brahman, afflictionless and attainable by knowledge.
Na bahirnantaram naham, na sankalpo na vigraha, idameva param brahma.
So take these things, take these things quite literally now. There is no outside, no inside, no I, no will, or no form. This alone is Supreme Brahman, afflictionless and attainable by knowledge. There is no outside, no inside, no I, no will, and no form. This alone is Supreme Brahman, afflictionless and attainable by knowledge.
Na satyam cha parityajya, na varta nartha dushanam, idameva param brahma.
There is no truth, none who has renounced, no accounts, no corruption of values. This alone is Supreme Brahman, afflictionless and attainable by knowledge.
Na guno guni vakyam va, na mano vritti nishchayah, na japam na parichinnam, na vyapakam asatphalam.
There is no quality, no qualified statement, no mental certitude, no japa, no limitation, nothing pervading and unreal fruits.
Na guru na cha shishyoha, na sthiram na shubha shubham, naika rupam na nyarupam, na moksho na cha bandhakam.
There is no guru, no disciple, nothing fixed, nothing auspicious or inauspicious, nothing uniform or of different form, no liberation and nothing that binds.
Aham padarthastat padamba, nendriyam vishayadikam, na samshayam na tuchamba, na nishchayam na vakritam.
There is no meaning for the word aham or the word that, no senses nor the objects, no doubt, nothing trifling, no certitude nor anything made.
Na shanti rupam advaitam, na chodham na chaneechakam, na lakshanam na dukkhangam, na sukham na chanchalam.
There is nothing of the form of peace, no non-duality, nothing above nor below, no trait no sorrowful body, no pleasure, and nothing fickle.
Na shariram na lingam va, na karanam karanam, na dukkham na adhikam na aham, na gudham na param padam.
There is no body, no sign, neither cause, nor the absence of cause. No sorrow, no conclusion, no I, nothing mysterious, and no transcendental state.
Na sanchitam janagami, na satyam cha pamahakam, na jnanam na cha vidyanam, na mudo na cha vigyavan.
There is no karma that is accumulated, nor that is yet to be realized. No truth, no you or I, no ignorance, no knowledge, no dunce, and no pandit.
Na nicham narakam nandam, na muktir na cha pavanam, na trishna na cha vidyatvam, na ham tattvam na devata.
There is no base hell, no conclusion, no liberation, and nothing purifying. No craving, no learning, no I, no knowledge, and no deity.
Na shubha shubha sanketa, na mrityur na cha jivanam, na triptir na cha bhojyam va, na khandekara sodvayam.
There is no sign of the auspicious or the inauspicious, no death, no life, no satisfaction, nothing enjoyable, no undivided unitary essence, and no non-duality.
Na sankalpam na prapanjam, na jagarana rajakam, na kinchit samata doshah, na tulya ganana brahmah.
Somebody want to read? You can read. My throat is not so.
There is no will, no world. There is no will, no world, no wakefulness or sovereignty, not even a trifle of the defect of equality. Not even a trifle of the defect of equality, whatever. No delusion of counting the fourth state.
Na sarvam samalam neshtam, na nirna cha pujanam, na prapancham na bhavna,
there is no all or impure, nothing adorable, no morality, no worship, no world, no plurality, no admixture of other saints.
Na satsangama satsangaha, na brahmana charanam, na vyasam na cha bhakta cha, na snanam na cha tirthakam.
There is no satsang or lack of satsang, no brahman, no inquiry, no practice, no speaker, no ablution, and no holy waters.
Na punyam na cha vapavam, na kriya dosha karanam, na chadhyatmam nadibhutam na daivatamasambhavam.
Sorry, I forgot you were reading.
There is no merit, nor there is sin, no actions causing defects, nothing related to the self, nothing related to the physical, nothing related to the divine.
Na janma marane kvapi jagrat swapna sushuptikam na bhulokam na patalam na jaya pajaya jayau.
There is no birth or death anywhere, no states of waking, dream and sleep, no realm of the earth or the netherworld, no victory or defeat.
Na heenam na cha vabhitihi na ratir na visvara achintyam na paradhyatma nidamagama vibhramaha.
There is no wretched, no fear, no sensuality, no quick death, nothing unthinkable, no one guilty, nor the delusion of sacred law.
Na sattvikam rajasam cha na tamasa gunadhikam na shaivam na cha vedantam na svadhyam tanna manasam.
There is no quality such as the serene or the active or the excessive dullness, no Shaivism, no Vedanta, no sacred study, nor the related interest.
Na bandho na cha moksho va na vakyam maikya lakshanam na sri rupam na pumbhavah na shando na sthirapadam.
There is no bondage, no liberation either, no sentence, no characteristics of identity, no female form, no male form, no condition of being neither male nor female, no permanent state.
Na bhushanam na dushanam na sutram na sudinahi na laukikam vaidikam na na shastram na cha shasanam.
There is no praise, no slander, no hymn, verily no eulogy, nothing worldly, nothing pertaining to the Vedas, no scripture, no any commandment.
Na panam na krisham neeram na modam na madamadam na bhavanam bhavova na kulam nama rupakam.
There is no drinking, no emaciation, none of this, no joy, no arrogance or absence of it, no mood or lack of it, no caste, no name and no form.
No krishtam cha ni krishtam cha na shreyo shreya evahi nirmalatvam malotsargah na jivo namadodamah.
There is nothing outstanding, nothing base, no prosperity, nor verily the opposite of it, no blemishlessness, nor excretion, no individual soul or control of mind.
Na shanti kalananagam na shantir na shamodamah, na krida na chabhavangam, na vikaram na doshakam.
There is no manifestation of peace, nothing attainable, no peace, no restraint of senses and mind, no sport, no part of existence, no transformation and no defect.
Na yat kinchin na yatraham, na maya khyana mayika, yat kinchin na cha dharmadi, na dharma paripidanam.
There is nothing whatsoever in the least, nothing of the I anywhere, nothing of what is called Maya, that is a delusive power, nothing associated with Maya, no righteousness anywhere in the least, no persecution of Dharma.
Na yovaram na balyam va, na jara maranadikam, na bandhur na cha va bandhu, na mitram na cha sodarah.
There is no youth, no boyhood, no senility, no death, and no death and such, no relative, no one unrelated, no friend and no brother.
So much for being in satsang today. Sadguru Shri Muji Baba ki
jai.
Sadguru Shri Ananta ji ki
jai.
Guru Kripa ke liye.